today's AGEC meeting here at headquarters. We'll crack straight on. We have a couple of apologies for absence. Councillor Brown and James Mason, our independent person, neither of those can make it today. And I can see that everybody else is here, so that's fantastic. I'm going to pass over to Angie now to give us the emergency evacuation procedures.
Thank you, Chair. We do not have any fire alarm testing scheduled today, so if the alarm does ring, then please exit building one of the rooms so that you can see there and follow one of us to the evacuation point.
Thank you very much. Are there any declarations of interest before we start? No, it's David.
Thank you, Joe. I'd like to declare that I have a small shareholding with a company called Good Energy, which is an energy provider, which might be relevant to future items on the agenda.
Thank you very much. Okay, that's noted. We haven't received any public access statements, and I don't believe we have any members of the public joining us at the moment. So we'll move straight on to agenda item 5, which is Chair's business. I've already welcomed you all to the meeting. I'd just like to confirm that we're recording this meeting for the public to view on the Fire Authority YouTube channel, and we're here today at the Police and Fire headquarters. I'm going to ask members to introduce themselves. I'll start with myself. I'm Councillor Bobbin. I represent Hartcliffe and the Ward in Bristol, and I chair the meeting.
I'm Councillor John Ash, and I represent Buggy Silk South in South Gloucestershire.
I'm Councillor Butters, Buffy and South of the Somerset.
Councillor Richard Sarrow, Western Supermarine Milton, North Somerset.
I'm Robert Payne, Councillor for Western Supermarine Central, North Somerset Council.
David Wilcox, representing Lockheed's Ward in Bristol.
Thank you. If I could just ask members to turn their name plates so that the camera can see how many people are sitting. It's just in front of you there, sorry. Shall we just... Fantastic. That's the one. Brilliant. Thank you. Okay, I'm now going to ask the officers to introduce themselves. I'll start with Steve.
Good afternoon. Good morning. Stephen Reed, one of the assistant chiefs.
Good morning, I'm Bill in Democratic Services.
Good morning, Luke Gazzard, Head of Response.
Good morning, Emma Harford, Environmental Manager.
Good morning, Caroline Taylor, Head of Corporate Assurance, Planning and Continuous Improvement.
Good morning, Claire Beckley, Head of Finance.
Good morning, Kevin Woodward, Interim Treasurer to the Authority.
Good morning, Amanda Brown, Clerk to Avon Fire Authority.
Good morning, Angie Feeney, Director of Corporate Services here at Avon Fire Rescue Service.
Thank you very much, all. And I'll ask others to introduce themselves before they speak. Can I ask everyone just please to remember to use your microphones? I know we can all hear in the room, but it's just to make sure that we're all clear on the YouTube channel. Voting today will take place by a show of hands, and again, to make it clear, I will ask for any votes against, any abstentions, and then any votes for. Right, there's a couple of bits of Chair's business. First off, I'd like to thank Councillors Ash and Butters for their service to the AGEC committee. I believe this is both your last meeting of AGEC. I know there's another full Fire Authority meeting to come. But thank you ever so much for your contribution over some years now. And I'm wishing you very well for what comes next. One other bit of business. Fire Authority has now published its pre-election guidance, which remain in place until the polls close on the 4th of May 2023. Elections are taking place for the unitary authorities above the North East Somerset, North Somerset and South Gloucestershire. Members and officers are encouraged to read the guidance and to act in accordance with it. Fire Authority meetings will continue to deal with the day-to-day business for the Fire Authority. Okay, thank you. That's all the admin out of the way. We are now moving on to agenda item 6, which is the minutes from the last meeting. Do we have any comments, additions, corrections from members about those? Neil?
Thank you, Chair. Just wondering, I may have been a bit slow picking it up, but I think we used to put in the names of members raising points. Not that I'm arguing one with another, but it's been an actual change in policy to put a member.
I don't think there's been a change of policy, but I'll make sure we include that in future.
I don't mind if it's a good idea or not. Okay, thank you.
No, it's probably best we, you know, put the initials of the member and so forth raising the point. That's a good point. Thank you, Neil. Are there any other points, additions, corrections on the minutes? No. Okay, well, I will move that they are a fair and accurate representation of what went on. Can I have a second up? Yeah, thank you very much. All those in, are there any votes against the minutes? No, any abstentions? And all those in favour? That's unanimous. Thank you very much. I will sign those and pass those to Emma at the end of the meeting. Okay, we'll move on to agenda item 7 and the substantive business today. 2021-22 Statement of Accounts, Report of the Treasurer, the External Audits ISA 260 Report. So, members will recall that at the last meeting of this committee, held on the 22nd of November.
Do you want to hand over to the Treasurer, the Interim Treasurer?
Okay. Thank you very much, Amanda. Sorry about that, Kevin.
Okay, yeah, we can do a double act. Yeah, good morning, members. So this item is item 7, it's not on page 13 of your agenda. So I have a short introductory report, but the main focus of this item is for the external auditors to give their audit opinion on the accounts for the year end of 31st March 2022. And we have Michelle from Deloitte here to take us through that in a moment. But just to go through, remind ourselves of the background. So yes, we are talking about the accounts for year end in March 22, so we're almost 12 months behind, or 12 months ago. So in some extent, there's no news, and very quickly we'll be looking at the accounts for the ending March 23. But as Paula just mentioned, at the previous meeting in November, we had hoped to receive the auditor's opinion and therefore sign off the accounts for the financial year. Unfortunately, we weren't able to do so for issues that Michelle had reported at the last meeting, which were that there was a backlog in terms of nationally, in terms of finalising external audits, and we were caught up in that. So unfortunately, we weren't able to do so, but we'd hoped to bring it to this committee. So it's pleasing that we now have an audit opinion, the ISA 260, at this meeting for us to consider. So in terms of the report itself, from my point of view, overall it is a positive report. But I'm conscious that Michelle has mentioned in the report that there are still some outstanding issues that they've been working on in the last week or so. And she indicated that she would probably update the committee today. So with that, I will hand over to Michelle to walk us through the report.
Thank you, Kevin. So I will take the report as read, but I will also highlight the key areas that...
Michelle, sorry, can I just ask you to introduce yourself as well? Thank you.
Sorry, I'm Michelle Hopton. I'm the audit lead responsible for the external audit. I'm from Deloitte. So I'll take the report as read, but I will highlight the key important items that I think we need to be aware of. Also happy to answer any questions at the end. So within the report, there is... it did highlight a number of outstanding errors, and that was based at the 10th of March. Obviously, time has moved on, and we've worked really hard to clear those down. I think, overall, it's a really positive position. We have completed all of the audit procedures with bar the pension fund. So there's one piece of evidence which we were waiting for from the pension fund. They came back last week to say they're looking to charged for that information. So we are looking at really understanding what the information, why our audit, our pension teams need that. So we challenge that view because I wouldn't want you to, you know, incur costs necessarily. So we are looking at that piece of work that came, I think, late last week. In relation to the Goodwin and the Clyde issue, we have concluded that. We've concluded that it's immaterial, so wouldn't look at you updating the financial statements. In relation to the accounts that you've got presented, we've reviewed those, and we're not expecting any significant changes to those, so we're expecting if you can approve those with some potential delegation if necessary. In relation to post-balance sheet events, which is noted in an outstanding area, there is something that's come up really hot off the press. It came up on Monday, and that's in relation to the pension fund signing off their triennial valuation. And what that process is looking at membership data as at the 31st of March 22, actually the year to sign that off. They're looking at signing that off towards the end of March. There have been indications from one actually that has highlighted a potential impact of the pension liability between 5 and 10%. So all firms, this isn't specific to the authority at all, this is a sector-wide issue that we are looking at working with our technical specialist to understand what Deloitte to do is on this potential post-balance sheet event, which as I said it came on Monday, so we're very early day to know what the impact is. I just wanted to highlight that to you, but that is something we will have to conclude before signing the opinion, but it isn't specific to you. But so I think overall really positive related to the fire authority audit that's happened, that we've covered off most of the areas. We are expecting an unmodified audit opinion based on all the testing we've done to date. We've got a comprehensive list of what I consider immaterial, incorrect misstatements, but obviously as an audit committee, you need to consider that, make sure you're comfortable that they remain uncorrected. So positive, just a last minute sector wide issue that we just need to bottom out. I'm hoping that by the end of this week we'll have a clear view on what that means and what the next steps are, but at this stage I'm not clear on what that is. Like I say, it's not specific to the authority, it's a wider sector issue. So happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Michelle. I'll open it up to members for questions. David?
Thank you, Chair. So, thank you for preparing this report. I'm interested in an issue about property re-evaluation, because I'm confused, and if I'm confused, that probably means a general member of the general public might well be confused. On page 20, we talk about a net loss of 4.7 million about property re-evaluation. Mm-hmm. Now that's over 10% of the value of our property estate, so that's quite a large figure. And then on page 29, we talk about a net gain of...
Of your report,
it's page 13. And then you talk about a re-evaluation of the assets from 46 million to 51 million, which is net gain of 5.2 million. So I'm just wondering why that's fluctuated in such a massive way. And also, to do with the fire authority accounts, on page 100 of the big bundle, there is a table about re-evaluations and property, and I can't find any figures that make your figures consistent with that, please.
I think in terms of reconciliation, I might take that away and look a bit more detail and give you that explanation of how the numbers reconcile. How they reconcile, I think I just need to think about that and present it with an email. In relation to the work we've done around property, we have had our retail specialists look at the valuations, review them, audit and challenge them, and they're comfortable with the valuations that have happened this year and obviously compared to last year. We didn't have a valuation last year, and we were comfortable at that point in time. We did have a full valuation this year, but I'd say that specialist, and review these salaries if we're comfortable with them, but let me take that away in terms of that reconciliation, I'll have to look at these numbers in a bit more detail.
I think I also read in the report that there was something about only doing desktop valuations. When is the next physical valuation going to be happening for our property sectors?
So I'm not sure when that would be. There's normally a cycle. It's normally at least every 5 years, with potential interim every three. I think it's based on policy and how I want to adopt that. But I suppose there's always a risk around how often you do these valuations. And obviously as auditors, we have to ensure that they're fair value. So we would look at getting our independent view on, you know, indices you've used in the interim, how you valued Hoyle for impairment. So I'm not sure, to be honest, when your next valuation is. I don't know if the authority, finance team, have that knowledge.
We'd look to do that in the next couple of years, so we probably wouldn't revalue next year because we've done the revaluation desktop exercise this year. But as Michelle said, that's the 3 or 5 years, so then we'd look in the fifth year at doing the full valuation.
But just what I would say, if you're not doing a valuation next year, even if it's not desktop, we would have to have a look at indices in the market. We understand what the potential impact is of not doing that, and be comfortable that it's not material. Because we will do that assessment and assess whether there is a material movement by not doing valuation.
Thank you. And I would welcome that email,
and
I think it could be included in the minutes. That would be very useful.
So I think I'm taking this action. If Councillor Wilcox can set out the questions or the pages that you would need to have reconciled, we can send that to Deloitte. And then when the answer comes back, we can publish that on modern.gov so the public can see it as well. That's not a problem. Okay.
That sounds great. Thank you. Thank you, David. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. So we've been pointed out that we're about a year late running at the moment. How confident can we be that we'll be more timely in future years, do you think?
Michelle, I mean, I'm aware that there's a national issue with the public sector audits. Would you like to comment?
Yes, that's fine. So in terms of the 23 audit, we have got resource planned out on a normal time scale, so in the summer. And we would look to complete it, you know, in a timely manner. The issue is, it's not necessarily specific to the system, but we couldn't sign some audits that could have been signed by the end of the year, because the pension audit hasn't completed, and the pension audit needs to be completed because they need to respond to our requirements in terms of their, you know, obligations to us as auditors. So where we're relying on third parties, that needs to supply us evidence, it's really hard to say that it actually can make, you know, an November deadline. But I think what we need to have is a project plan that sets out that we are going to be done by, you know, the deadline, and clear actions and hold to account on that. But if there is a third party, you know, that's the only thing that's outstanding, that needs to be where we, you know, aim to be, and that should be what we target our success on.
Thank you, Michelle.
Yeah. Well, I won't be here, but you can see how it is. Thank you. I appreciate the respect.
Thank you. Yeah. Do any other members have questions for Michelle?
Can I just clarify? So, at the moment, we've got a recommendation to approve the final set of accounts to be published. I know you said there's outstanding pension information. Does that mean that the accounts can't be approved today and we must keep them in draft format? I'm guessing that's the case.
Yes, so I can't sign the audit opinion until that bit's completed.
Okay.
Again, that's not specific to you, that's the authority's information.
No, that's fine. We just need to craft alternative recommendations, that's all. So, are there any further questions from members before we come up with some wording for the recommendations? No? Okay. So I suggest we say that the committee is asked to review and approve the draft 21-22 statement of accounts to the court. So that would be A. B, to note the delay and receipt of, would it just be appropriate to say pension information?
Yeah.
Pension information.
and the need to include this information in the draft statement of accounts before they can be shared on the website?
I probably the potential impact. There might not be an impact.
And need to include any impact in the draft statement of accounts, and then to delegate approval of the final statement of accounts once updated with the pension information to the Fire Authority. Last time we did it, to the Fire Authority Chair, the Chair of AJEC, and the Treasurer. So is everybody comfortable? Do you want me to go through that again? Okay, that's fine. Okay, so the committee is asked to review and approve the draft 2021-2022 Statement of Accounts Narrative Report, which you've got with this report. B, to note the delay in the receipt of pension information and the need to include any impact of that in the draft Statement of Accounts before the Statement of Accounts and Narrative Report is shared on the Fire Authority website. And C, to delegate final approval of the Statement of Accounts once updated with the pension information to the Fire Authority Chair, the AJEC Chair, and the Treasurer. Is everybody comfortable? Are we comfortable to propose and second those recommendations on block? Is everybody happy with that? Yeah? Robert?
Okay, so with those amended recommendations, I'd like to propose that that's what we do.
Can we have a second, Jeff?
Yeah, that's brilliant, thank you. So, any votes against those recommendations? Are there any abstentions? And any votes in favour?
Thank you.
So that's carried. Thank you.
And I'll make sure you send me the questions as soon as possible, then that can all be resolved while the accounts are still draft. So that would be so helpful.
Brilliant, thank you. Okay, so we'll move on to agenda item 8, which is the external audit value for money report. And I believe Deloitte will be presenting on this.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. So this is the annual value for money report. This is, I would say, in draft, because we have to issue it in final the same day we sign the opinion. But what I would say, we're not looking to do any more work around this. The work is complete, so this draft should be, in effect, the final version. In terms of the report, we'll take it as read, again, highlighting maybe the key areas. So we've issued a positive value for money statement with no significant weaknesses or recommendations, which is positive. I think notes of the journey that the authority's been on over the last number of years. There's nothing to highlight, so there's no significant weaknesses, but I haven't answered any questions. We have nothing else specifically to highlight.
Thank you, Michelle, and thank you for yours and Doris' work on this. Do members have any questions or the BFM report? Yep.
That's not a question, but I was pleased to see a couple of times we're expecting to issue an unqualified opinion, so that's good news.
Absolutely. Thank you.
In terms of a recommendation for this report, I suggest that members vote to note the draft value for money report, yes, with the final to be signed off by Deloitte after you've issued your final audit report, yes?
Yes, it should come on the same day as a final BFM final opinion.
Okay. So, so members are to note the draft external audit value.
Thank you. So I propose that we do note the report. Do I have a second for that? Yeah, okay. Thank you. Do we have any votes against? Do we have any abstentions? And votes in favour? Thank you. That's unanimous. Okay. Swiftly on to item 9, which is the annual governance statement. And I think Caroline
yes, correct.
Is presenting on this.
Yes.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, members. Each year we're required to produce an annual government statement to comply with the accounting audit regulations 2015. I'd like to remind members that a draft copy of the 2021-22 annual government statement was presented to members at the AJEC committee in September 2022 for approval pending two updates which are outstanding from the 21 and 22 external audit. The updates outstanding were on page 83 with sections 8.2 and 8.3 needing to be updated with the external auditor's opinion on the financial statements and on how we provide value for money when their work is completed. As you've heard, the external auditors have now substantially completed the outstanding audit and value for money work and have advised that they envisage issuing an unmodified audit opinion and have not identified any significant weaknesses in the authority's value for money arrangements. You will see in the paper in front of you, which is page 173 of the report pack, captured under section 1, there are two bullet points which provide the updates to paragraphs 8.2 and 8.3 to be added to the annual government statement and then published. I'd like to reassure members that the annual government statement will only be updated and published with these statements once external audit finalise confirm their unmodified and unqualified opinion. In the unlikely event that these opinions change when external audit conclude their audit, the wordings of paragraphs 8.2 and 8.3 will be referred back to the committee for further consideration. So, we can go on to the recommendations. Yes.
Thank you, Caroline. Do any members have questions on those? Okay, well, recommendations as set out by Caroline, where the committee is asked to approve the inclusion of paragraphs 8.2 and 8.3 as above in the published annual government statement 21-22 as soon as external audit finalised the audit of the accounts and confirmed their unqualified opinion. And should the opinion of external audit change, the wording of the AGS in respect of paragraphs 8.2 and 8.3 will be referred back to the committee for further consideration. So I'd like to propose that we act on those recommendations and approve the inclusion of the paragraphs. Do I have a second, David? Thank you very much. Do I have any votes against that? Any abstentions? And all those in favour, please. That's unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay, moving on to agenda item 10, which is the internal audit reports and internal audit plan 23-24. I'm going to pass over to RSM, and if you could just introduce yourself before you start. Thank you.
Good morning, members. So I'm Sam from the internal audit team, RSM. So I will take you through the first report, which is the financial controls internal audit report. So in our audit plan each year, we include the financial controls audit, and the one for this year looked at the purchase to pay process. So the scope of this audit included a walkthrough and some testing around the P2P process, just making sure that there's compliance against the key financial policies that are in place. We also reviewed the controls for the checking and reporting of supplier data, and we also looked at the setup of new suppliers and the process in place for changes to current supplier details. This is a high risk area which we tend to include in our financial controls audit just because of the risk of fraudulent supplier payments. So overall, the audit resulted in a reasonable assurance opinion with two medium priority actions and two low priority actions. So I'll take you through the medium options first. So these were around the final checks for supplier payments, just making sure that there is evidence of the approval process in line with delegated authority. Good practice, which we tend to see elsewhere, is just recording that final sign of those payments. We did note that with the SLA in place with Bristol City Council and obviously the finance team, there is that segregation of duties. But again, bring that back to good practice is just making sure that there is that audit trail in place. moving on to the two low actions. So the first one was around the control for supplier changes. So whilst we observe that there is that control for everything in place, again, it's just coming back to having that evidence, an audit trial of those checks that take place kind of in the background. And the second row of action was focused around just updating the financial procedures, so a bit more of a housekeeping point, and just to make sure that they are looked at annually, just to make sure they're reflecting the current working practices. As usual, the report is by exception, and so there are a number of well-designed controls, which you can see on page 5 against the green ticks. In addition, we've also added in some good practice points for the service to consider as they move through the devolved budget framework. That's it from me. I'm not sure if Claire wanted to add any context in terms of the report or the actions that we've raised, but if not, I'll happily take any questions.
Just to say that those actions have now been completed, and hopefully you now see the evidence of those. So if we have taken those on board, or we see have changed those procedures to reflect the new way of working.
Thank you very much. We're dealing with a block of four reports here, the internal audit report, the internal audit report, operational assurance, progress report, and the internal audit plan. I didn't know if there's any, Mark, were you presenting on this or?
I was going to take the rest of the list. Do you want me to do that now?
Well, we can quickly take questions on this, yeah. Just to check if there are any questions.
Thank you, Chair. I've got a couple of questions about the packages that have been used, Gresso and Oshams from a company called out of the box, when you install them, that you have to create your own account databases. But there is the ability to link in with Active Directory, so accounts are managed properly from a single source. Is any of that functionality enabled?
So our Aggresso system is provided through Bristol City Council.
Right.
So we obviously work within the framework that they've set up for us. But we do work closely with them to ensure obviously that we can put the checks in place. But ultimately they make those changes. So it's, yes, we do have the ability to do that, but we have to go to Bristol City Council to do it.
Okay. And the same for options?
That's not one of our.
Councillor, so anyone from Health and Safety is going to use their system, right. So I think what we all need to do is take that and ask the subject matter experts to come back to the one app.
Yes, please. Thank you.
Thank you, David. And all that is way above my pay grade, I'm afraid. But thank you for your technical expertise. Do we have any other questions on the first part? Okay. So, move on to them.
Good morning everyone, I'm Mark Jones from RSN. So the second audit that we got for you is on operational assurance. So the background to this is that there's guidance from the National Fire Chiefs Council that operational audits should be undertaken and use them as a means to ensure the organisation has a state of readiness for operational response. So what we have in place here is a process of what we want to call 8-7. Quality assurance audits have been completed by station managers and they're uploading using the online health and safety reporting system, OSHAMS, as was referred to earlier. So we've looked at the process for doing these operational audits. You'll see that we've concluded with reasonable assurance opinion. We've raised 6 low priority and 1 medium priority action. In general, we think that the framework is in place to monitor compliance with workforce standards and that there is clearly established policy and process documentation. And that there was an internal evaluation review of QA processes. The main area where we did agree that the medium priority action was around the end process in the system, which was around the performance-related reporting to provide that assurance into the wider fire authority governance forums, potentially SLT or perhaps the Performance Review and Scrutiny Committee, and we've agreed an action for consideration to be given about where that reporting should flow through to, and that's, I think, a key part of this audit and the whole process is around operational assurance. Where is that assurance going and what's going to happen to it? So that's the key element from this. There were six low priority actions. I'm not going to take you through them. They've been agreed with management, with time scales, etc. But the theme in those, in the main, if there was a theme, it is around evidence, keeping the evidence for the auditing that's been done. I mean, it's a standard audit practice that if there's no evidence, it hasn't happened. So it's largely this theme in those actions around the retention of evidence. I'll pause at that point and take any questions on the audit.
Thank you, Mark. Do members have questions on the operational assurance? No? Okay, thank you. Move on to the progress report.
Right. So the progress report is in our usual standard format. So it highlights the fact that since you last met, we've issued two reports in the final form that we've just discussed. You'll see that there is one piece of audit work that is in progress. It was delayed due to some personnel issues in the health and safety team, so we had to delay that audit from the original timescale. But it is in progress. We'll be shortly completing and we'll report the final version of that through to your May meeting. So that would be the final piece of work. Just to say also that that we'll be conducting our follow-up work throughout the year. The process has been to validate the actions that have been reported as closed to your meeting. So later on the agenda, you've got a report from management stating which actions have been closed. RSM have validated the accuracy of that closure. So you can take some assurance that the management are reporting a true state of affairs and the closure of actions. But we will provide a summary position of all of that closure to the beginning of the May meeting, along with our annual report. sort of a verbal heads up on where that annual opinion is likely to land. At the moment, there is nothing from our auditing that we've conducted so far that would lead to a negative opinion, but there's still one audit to complete, which is the health and safety injury management one. So subject to that one landing with a satisfactory assurance level, then it will be a clean opinion. I think that's probably all I wanted to say on the progress report. So again, I'll pause at that point.
Thank you, Mark. Do members have questions on the progress report?
Okay, I'll carry on then. So the next paper is a paper that sets out our proposed internal audit plan for 2023-24. The paper outlines the process that we've gone through, and that's been through discussions with the management team. And we've agreed a position with them around a series of audits that you'll see are linked to key risks with the fire authority. We've agreed a very high level sort of scopes of what those audits would cover and how that would be reported throughout the year. So I think the key things for you to consider are does the plan reflect the assurance needs that as a committee you might reflect, and do you recognise the risks in attempting to provide assurance on the mitigating controls? We will always be flexible, although we'll be asking for you to approve the plan as one of the recommendations. During the year, we will be flexible if assurance needs change. You'll see in the plan that there are a series of audits that didn't quite make the cut, shall we say, in this plan, but could be considered for future plans. They could be ones that might be considered if something in the plan needs to drop out for operational reasons. And there is there is a small element of contingency time available to carry forward from a current year, the time that wasn't used due to the cancellation of an audit. So it's a little bit of contingency to play with for flexibility next year. I think that's probably, I wasn't going to go through the individual audits in the plan. They're there for you to consider. I'll also take any questions on that.
Thank you, Mark. It's good to hear that there is that sort of flexibility to address issues as they arise.
Do we have any questions from members on that? No? Okay, well, thank you guys from RSM for your work on this. So, the recommendations we have for agenda item 10 to consider the internal reports, the findings, and agreed management actions for the key financial controls, purchase and pay, which is in Appendix 1, the operational assistance, operational assurance, sorry, SOPH 7, Appendix 2, to consider the progress report, Appendix 3, and to consider and approve the internal audit plan, 23-24, which is Appendix 4. So we're going to deal with these in one block. Okay, I'd like to propose that we follow those recommendations. Joanne, second that? John, thank you very much. are there any votes against those recommendations? Are there any abstentions? And what's in favour? That's unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay. Moving on to agenda item 11, which is the update on internal audit recommendations. I think Caroline is presenting on this.
Yes. Okay, so the update on internal audit recommendations. This report has two recommendations, the first of which is to note the progress made against the internal audit recommendations and management actions. If I can ask members to turn to Appendix 1 on page 234. I'd like to start by saying that I'm pleased to report that significant progress has been made this year with the completion of internal audit actions, with the final outstanding actions for the audit year 2020-21 now all closed. For the year 2021-22, out of the 51 actions, we have three remaining open, and good progress has also been made in the current financial year, with four actions already completed out of the 13 actions identified. However, please note that the seventh audit was not finalised in time of conclusion this time round, but it's just been presented to you by Mark. As you will see, looking at the overall picture, the three tables in Appendix 1%, from the 2020-21, 21-22 and 22-23 audits, there were a total of 100 audit actions agreed, and of these 100 audit actions, 88 actions have now been closed, and 12 actions remain outstanding and on track for completion. On page 235, Appendix 2 gives you a summary of progress against those actions for 21-22, which is still open. And likewise, on page 238, Appendix 3 gives you the summary of progress against those actions for the current 22-23, which is still open. That's my update on how we are progressing with implementing our internal audit actions. Against this background of making positive progress with our monitoring and completion of internal actions, with all the outstanding actions in 2021 now complete, we're also recommending that with our increased efficiency and fewer outstanding actions to monitor, that in the new municipal year, an update is provided to AJEC twice a year. Progress will continue to be tracked by the Corporate Assurance Team, Internal Audit and SLT regularly, and updates will remain available to members on request. So, any questions, please, before handing back the recommendations?
Thank you, Caroline. So, going forward, we will internal audit recommendations and the corporate risk register in rotation.
Correct.
Brilliant, thank you. Do members have any questions for Caroline? I'd just like to say as well, thank you, for the work, the way the progress is going is fantastic. So we'll move on to the recommendations. We are asked to note progress made against the internal audit recommendations and management actions, and to approve post-change in internal audit recommendations reporting frequency from four times a year to twice yearly commencing in the new municipal year.
So I'd like to propose that. Do I have a seconder? John, thank you very much. Do we have any votes against? Any abstentions? All those in favour? That's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you, Jane. You're also up, I believe, for the next one as well, which is the corporate risk register.
Yes. Okay, so item 12. So I'd like to present this paper for consideration and noting. The corporate risk register is subject to regular review by the senior leadership team and presented to this committee twice a year. During regular reviews, each corporate risk is evaluated by the risk owner, who will take account of the current risk environment, the control measures in place, and the plan mitigations to manage the risk, after which a determination of the likelihood and impact of the risk will be made. There is also a regular schedule of corporate risks that are examined in more detail by the senior leadership team, known as deep dives, to ensure detailed scrutiny and challenge takes place. Service Leadership Board review the highest level and newly emerging risks at their regular meetings. In addition, the Treasurer undertakes a review of the corporate risk, financial risk, to provide additional assurance. If I can ask members to turn to page 244 of your committee papers and direct members to look at section 5.1, you will note there are currently three risks on the full corporate risk register which are rated as high but remain static, all with a score of 21, which is highly probable with a major impact. These are CRO3, response and rescue, but this high score was impacted by the threat of industrial action, but in light of the recent pay award, there has been consideration of lowering the score to 15, which will be considered at our next service leadership team meeting at the end of March. CRO4, people, capacity, capability and resilience. CRO18, business continuity management. As reported to members at AGEC in June 2022, a new risk was identified as needing to be captured in the corporate risk register, which was CRO21, environmental compliance and net zero carbon. And that's now been added following approval of the proposed risk at SLT in June 2022. If I can ask members to turn to Appendix 1, page 247, this provides members with a summary table of all 18 risks on our corporate risk register and their current risk rating. If I can ask you now to turn to Appendix 2, on page 249, this table lists all the 18 corporate risks and provides details of the direction of travel over the last 3 months. As you will note, the first risk, CRO1, performance targets, had a movement in its risk scores, which has risen from 13 to 15 since December, because the likelihood of us not achieving some of our performance targets of our performance scorecard has increased from possible to probable. The performance scorecards are scrutinised in detail at the PRC committee, but to give you some idea, metrics of target impacted this risk score changing, including sickness targets, home fire safety visits, completions, reductions in carbon emissions, and building regulations. Then finally, members will see a copy of the full corporate risk register as of the 22nd of February, which can be found in Appendix 3 on pages 251 to 270. Here members can see full details for each of these corporate risks in terms of their scores, controls in place, the plan mitigations, and the latest supportive commentary. I'd also ask you to note that following the request at the AGEC meeting in June 2022, the date the risk was first added to the corporate risk register has now been added in the first column. So that was a request that was made. And finally, Appendix 4 on page 273 provides members with the risk matrix and definitions for reference. So that concludes my presentation. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much, Caroline. Thank you, Chair. Thanks very much for that. And it was just on the governance
impact on the waiting for the external audit accounts and us having to publish the delay is one of the factors it's influenced, and we use that information to obviously as a major control for our governance risks. There was also, when this was called, the potential for industrial action at the time. This was obviously having a significant impact on staff's capacity and time to provide us potentially with all the updates and information we normally rely on in terms of governance, so that was taken into account as well. We also have a vacancy still in the governance team, which is also still having some impact on our ability to do all the areas of development that we would like and continue to improve, that we have made, as you can see from the updates today, significant progress with how we are monitoring and reporting against the work we're doing, but there's more we'd like to do. And we are obviously waiting also for the governance review that's been carried out as part of the LGA peer review and the findings from that. So there's some of the reasons that have driven that decision. Yes.
Neil, you've got a question.
Thank you, Chair. Two, actually. One is, I'm rather concerned about Bath Fire Station not being rebuilt as we'd hoped. I don't know how soon that could be addressed in general, but I'm just wondering whether that presents in itself some form of enhanced risk.
Entirely sure who to address that question to.
We don't have a representative from Property Services here today. I think we've addressed that at previous meetings.
Yeah, I can respond on general terms, and if the question is potential risk in terms of operational response, then I'm sure my colleague can also. Is that the nature of your concern, in particular the risk of operational response? Or?
Well, I suppose that would be central, but not exclusively, because there are issues over storage. On site at various things, aren't there?
Okay, so if I respond on the general terms, then you did look at the kind of operational. So yeah, you would have seen from the capital programme approved by the fire authority that we don't intend to move forward with the redevelopment of Western Bath within this next financial year. That's due to a number of reasons, in particular. The financial situation that was also highlighted at the last Bar Authority meeting, and also that will incur you to borrow, and of course, borrowing costs are high at this point. However, we have.
I'm aware of that, but yeah. I'm just wondering what additional risks it might pose.
Yeah, so it does pose, from a premises point of view, it does pose a risk of potential failure of some aspect of that building, so in particular. Roof or heating or in that element, which is why we've put £100,000 aside in the budget to make provision should we have a significant failure on some element of that kind of premises. Don't know whether you want to make seen in terms of the operational aspect of it.
I think just leading on from what Andrew's just said about the additional money to put aside for maintenance of the building, whilst it's on walls. As approved by the Fire Authority in February, there'll be a review ongoing on how we potentially make the building as effective and efficient environmentally, as much as anything else, over the next 12 months, whilst that pause is in place. Operationally, that won't have any impact at all on the delivery of service, both from a response, prevention, or protection perspective.
Okay, thank you. I mean, how soon do you think it might be brought back over that anniversary?
I think these are considerations over the next year. We do obviously need to look at the financial climate around the point of borrowing, obviously keep an eye on the Bath and how that premises is doing. And also, it links to the ongoing work, also looking at JTC and what that might mean for the future design of that. Training. So I think certainly when you said over the next financial year, we will need to have a plan when we are going to deal with Bath, because obviously it's one of our high priority sites to actually redevelop given the condition of the site at the moment. So we expect to have clarity on when and in what format over the next year, next financial year.
Chair, I was just a bit concerned there's rather a lot of red appearing in this report, and I'm just wondering if we were 1 year on, is that likely to have diminished, or are we still going to face problems like this?
Well, there's three risks that are red out of the 18, and as I've stated, the response from rescue is likely to be approved to come down at the end of March, because that went up as a result of industrial action, which will then leave us two risks. The business continuity management's also been significantly impacted by industrial action, but they identified that there's further continuity plan and exercise for work they want to do, which is why they're keeping the score up until they've seen all that work through and they're happy they've got the plans in place. So that will also be in the horizon to be reviewed, and I think is likely to come down also in the future. The people, capacity, capability and resilience also impacted by industrial action, but that's not the only reason it's scored highly and might potentially still stay red, because resourcing and getting staff has been an issue. So we are reviewing that closely at SLT and keeping an eye on it. So I think overall, the big picture is there is currently three reds. I anticipate that probably dropping down to one or two in the next month or two. I think that's not a significantly high number. They've been closely managed, they've been closely monitored, and we are doing our best to get those risks down and under control.
And I suppose it's important not to reduce them too quickly, because then you can sort of, you know, say, well, there's no more work needed on this. So, as you say, Neil, are you happy with that?
Thank you.
Okay. David.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to talk about CR06 on page 256. I'm very pleased to see that the emergency services network has been at this risk. It's really important. Really acknowledge that. This has been delayed by white people for multiple years. I wonder if we can actually have a briefing about how we are mitigating the risk from that. Because when I went to the CBRA exercise in Avon recently, it was painfully obvious that all the emergency services are having huge issues about radio communications. I'd like to understand what's happening about that risk, please.
Thank you. Again, I'm not entirely sure.
I think that's probably a topic we can deal with at a member development session, where we have subject matter experts come in and give members a full briefing. So I've noted that, and I'll make sure I take that away.
Thank you.
Also, Council Lawcotts did attend an exercise, which I think was useful, so we will be opening up the opportunity to other members who may be interested to do that.
I thoroughly recommend any member taking the opportunity to go and see an exercise like that. See drills on the station, but actually seeing it in an overall environment like that is really important.
Sounds fantastic. And could you just CBRN, is that chemical?
Chemical, biological, radiological, and nuclear.
Thank you very much. That's explained it. Do members have any other questions for Caroline at this point on the corporate risk register? No? Okay. Well, so I need to get my papers back in order. So, agenda item 12, the recommendations are that we review the corporate risk register in respect to the risks in this report and consider the controls and mitigations in place to manage these risks, and consider whether we need any further information to be assured of the appropriate management of these corporate risks. So I would like to propose that we have reviewed and considered. Do you want to have a second, Neil? Again, thank you. Any votes against? Any abstentions? And all those in favour?
Yeah.
you're voting on the fact that you have reviewed the CRR and you've considered and you've decided that there is not any further information. Say for Councillor Wilcox, who I will arrange a group of people about the communication system between the services. It's not an approved document, it's just confirmed that you've approved the corporate risk register as it is.
Yeah. It's more that we're happy with, you know, the work that's been done in the direction of travel fuel. So that's, I'll repeat, but that is carried unanimously. Fantastic. Okay. Well, we're at the end of the items to consider. We're now moving on to agenda item 13, which is the date of the next meeting. Which is currently planned for Tuesday the 27th of June 2023 at 10:30, and again it will be here at Main Conference Room at Police and Fire Headquarters in Portishead. Okay, so we come to agenda item 14, which is exclusion of the press and the public. So I'd like to resolve the public meeting.